Hey, welcome back. Today we are going to be discussing this Dio motor, which I got in on the bench. It has a pretty good oopsie, and we're going to be discussing the points of failure on it, what I see, and what I think were the two leading causes of some problems that this motor had, and how to fix them. And then maybe in a later episode we'll show the rebuild and some other stuff. I'm also going to hopefully get into the intake porting, which this one is stock, and the manifold hasn't been done either, so a little bit of talk about what I like to do there. And yeah, let's get right into it. So we have here a 48 mil Tata bore. As you can see around the transfer ports there, it's looking pretty hurt. The failure point on this, I mean, other than there's some scuffs from a soft seize, but the failure point here was the circlip walking out, and it's basically destroyed the motor. I was actually riding beside the guy when it happened. It just lost all its power and made a funny noise, and then made no power and wouldn't start. But let's take a look at the piston here. And there's our culprit there. There's a small piece of the circlip from the opposite side that has wedged itself into the piston. As you can see, it's got G-clips. And from what I've always done and been taught is this is installed incorrectly. So you can see it's at 9 o'clock here, the clip. It should be at 12 or 6, top or bottom basically. So yeah, you can see there it's spatted out pretty good on this side too. So this piston is no good, and that bore, it could be saved. You could hone it out to 50 mil, put a 50 mil piston in it. Is that worth it? They're like a $100 cylinder. Probably not. Failure point two was this. So this is a CT intake, great value, very cheap. You can get them for around 20 bucks a piece. Problem number one was there was no gaskets installed on the reed block, and it was just sandwiched in there. And if you look really close, you can see the witness marks where this surface was clamping on here. You can kind of see that different color. But then along here, you see no witness marks. So what that tells me is this is probably Air Leak City. These are great. Don't get me wrong. For 20 bucks, I mean, it gives you a pretty nice reed block. These are kind of junky. They have a tendency to blow apart. And you need to do a bit of pre-finishing on these. So what you need to do is get yourself a piece of sandpaper and a flat surface, such as like the metal bench here. So what you need to do is get yourself a piece of sandpaper and a flat surface and just like lap it on there until it goes like this one. So this one has been lapped. I have cleaned it up quite a bit. You can see all the lines that you can see on this one are gone. You need to do that to this surface, and this surface. It also doesn't hurt to do it to this, just lightly, like 400 grit, 600 grit sandpaper kind of thing. And this side's a little harder to do, but at the very least, take a very fine file and just take those little casting lines off of there, and that will help immensely. And then also, like I said, run the gaskets. Some of these I've seen are quite cupped, and they usually are cupped around the ears. So even if you run a gasket, if you don't level out the edges of the casting here, you still end up with like a dip in the sealing surface, and then you get air leaks, and then your motor goes kaput. This definitely soft seized at one point in time. Upgrade number two to these is to just get a different reed block. I don't know where I've acquired, well, this one's a stage 6 one. I actually used a different one on my Hobbit. So I have this one in the bin, so I'm probably going to use this one. This one's full rubber coated. So this one you don't actually need a gasket for, but I probably will put some Honda Bond on there just to make sure. And then this one I don't know where I acquired it from, but it also fits. And yeah, these are the weak points in these kits. The reeds aren't great. The plastic is not great. They can kind of break, especially if it backfires. They kind of blow apart. It's just not a great plastic. But there are upgrade options. Like I said, you can get like a stage 6 one or other manufacturers. This is a semi common bolt pattern. You can also get either a V-Force out of a KX65 or RM65 will also work. I don't have one on hand here, but they're a good option for these, although a bit pricey. And you can find some clone ones on the old AliExpress if you're so inclined. We're gonna tear the rest of this apart, and I'm gonna talk about the build that I'm gonna do, which is kind of fun because it's not the crank that's going in it. I think for this one is gonna be pretty special. It's kind of like a hodgepodge that I put together, which could be replicated at home. It just uses a longer rod, and it's gonna be a mini stroker. And the theory behind that is hopefully more RPM happy, and maybe a little bit more longevity, because with the longer rod, hopefully it will keep the thing together. Mini stroke cranks have a little bit of a notoriety, especially some brands that use the 16 millimeter pin ones, of not holding together very long. Looks like we also need a bushing. And because this crank ate a bunch of clip pieces, I'm probably not gonna use it again, so I am just gonna knock it apart. If you wanted to keep this crank, I would highly recommend using a puller, pulling on it equally, but in this case, I think this one's already too far gone. Yeah, there's little bits of circlip all through. Luckily, it looks like it didn't lock up the bearing though, and spin it. It looks perfectly reusable. Somebody already did the solid and did the oil pump delete. So this is a mostly stock AF18 case. What I like to do when importing these is I go wider and go down into the floor a little bit, and you can take about, I would say no more than half, and that half would be extremely aggressive just because the cylinder punches through on the top here. So if you take half of this out of here, you're actually gonna be paper thin here. You can build up the top of this, clean it up, put some JB, Devcon, whatever you have, some type of a epoxy in here, and you can pour it up into that more aggressively. But this supports your cylinder and your intake, so you don't want this to be paper thin because it's just not ideal. The thinner this gets, the more it's going to be affected by heat, and then potentially you end up with an air leak here or an air leak on this part of your cylinder. Again, don't touch this bridge. You can clean it up if it's got casting flaws on it, but I would not do much other than just clean it up. Don't knife edge it, just radius the edges nice and leave it there. You can go down into the floors here quite a bit. I believe I've cut one of these off before. You have about a mil to a mil and a half. It depends on the casting. This casting is actually pretty nice. I've seen worse. So you can go probably like half a millimeter down and blend this in a little bit more. And you just have to be mindful that you can punch through into the variator side, both on the back part and down into the floor. The other thing that I usually do is I will blend this out a little bit. I don't touch up here pretty much at all. A, because the reed block comes in and gets to about there-ish. So you want to kind of blend this out a little bit inside of here. Like down right in there. But you don't want to like open this up a whole bunch. These already have a massive case volume because the reed stuffer's up here and then the oil pump and shit. So I just try and keep it as low volume as... keep the volume as low as possible. I've toyed with the idea of filling this in with like some Devcon or like something of that sort, just to like anchor something in there to try and fill up this weird little shelf where the reed valve comes in, but it's not again, it's not like super critical, but you can see what I mean, that this is kind of just like a dead zone. You really don't need to do anything in there. You can clean it up and make it look nice, but it doesn't... you put the reed in there and you open the pedals, you can see probably just barely, but you can kind of see that you're blending this out a little bit, doing a little bit of work on just on this radius is probably more important than doing literally anything in there. The other thing I like to do with these CTs is all these casting flash edges. They can make the reed get hung up. It's depending on the reed you put in there. Like that one's pretty loose, but this stage 6 one, which is rubberized, kind of hits those casting marks. So if you go in and just like around that edge, just kind of take some of the material away, that's pretty good. And that's pretty much it. One other thing that I've done on the past two, I haven't built one of these in a while, but the past two of these that I built was putting a plug in here, filling 90% of this void that's behind this bearing in with like Devcon or JB or whatever you have. On this one, I'm going to have to make a passage that comes through with this pipe. It gets into this space so that the vacuum fuel pump can still work, which isn't a huge deal. But I'm going to fill this all in just because, again, take case volume down to a more smaller amount. The in behind here is huge. It is a massive, massive cavity. I would say it's probably almost as big as most of the intake tract, like in behind this bearing pocket area. It's massive. And lastly, we'll talk about the cranks real quick. So this is a stock boy. This is my custom boy, a Pro X 03.1102, which I believe is a 91 millimeter length rod. On a CMR mini stroker that the pin's been machined from 16 to 18, so you can use a bigger bearing. I think this motor, I'm gonna put this one in, which will mean I'll have to run a base gasket, but it's the benefits of the longer rod. So most of these mini strokers still use a stock length rod, but with a longer stroke, your rod stroke ratio gets more extreme at 3 and 9. The bearing has to move faster at those points. So if you lengthen the rod, it actually decreases the amount of angle that the rod has to go to, which slows down the bearing and provides a bit more stability to everything. So we'll see. It's a little bit experimental, but I think it may work. It's also a way beefier, way nicer rod. Pro X makes pretty nice stuff, made in Japan. So I think on this motor, we're going to use this one, and then I'm going to be building another one for the gentleman, and we'll use this crank and that one. That's pretty much it for this one. There's going to be other porting. We're going to be doing gasket matching the cylinder to the crankcase halves, cutting in the boost port, which I've kind of moved away from filling this in and cutting a big thing with an end mill, and just going to be cutting like a taper cut, again, to keep the case volume as small as possible. Next one, we'll be doing some porting and dry fitting the crank once I clean the stink out of these cases. They are very gross. But yeah, that's it. Until next time, take care.